This is Lynette Pearson, and this is the Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a nonpartisan 100-year-old organization that believes that democracy depends on well-informed and active participation. For more voter information, please visit our website, Vote 411, before you mark your ballot. Today, we welcome Dacia Grayber, who's running for state representative, District 35. Hello.
Hi, thank you very much for having me.
Tell us a little bit about your background and why you're running for the state seat.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity again. So my name is Dacia Grayber, and I am an almost two-decade online fire and paramedic. I work for Tualatin Valley Fire and Rescue, so I have a lot of experience in the area that I would love to serve. And I was 10 years old when I decided that I wanted to be a firefighter, but I was told the girls don't do that. And so I have spent my whole life, from my career to where I am right now, redefining what's possible and breaking boundaries and doing things that I was told were impossible. Whether that was addressing the houselessness situation and medical care access for folks in Tigard with the Compassionate Care Center, working on paid family leave, fighting against gun violence, and working for stronger worker protections, I've been on the front lines, informed by the things that I've seen in my field. I'm also a mom and stepmom of four teenagers, so I bring that perspective with me as well. And right now, you know, the things I see in the field have really informed why I'm running, but there's never been a clearer lens for that than for what we're going through right now with the COVID-19 crisis. So I see how the gaps in wealth and in equity and all the services that we have widened in this, and we have a very clear mandate to act to take care of people, and I believe I'm uniquely positioned to do that.
Thank you. In light of the COVID pandemic, there's going to be some very difficult budgetary choices for the legislature going forward. What do you think should be top priorities for the legislative agenda in 2021?
So everything is going to be seen through that COVID-19 lens, right? All the things that we thought we were going to do, we can't back away from the programs that support our most vulnerable communities, but now we need to look at how do we get Oregon back to work and how do we take care of people. So we absolutely need to protect public health care programs, and we make sure that every Oregonian has access to health care, access to housing, access to the very basic needs. And you know, those are things that we were looking at before, but the line between keeping people housed and people becoming houseless is much thinner now. And then secondly, we have to look at ways to get our small businesses back up and running and how to get people to work, back to work. So innovative, I almost think this is a time to think bold and big as well and look at infrastructure projects that use local worker and materials. And also removing red tape, making loans accessible, other than that, just to get people back to work. So those need to be our two biggest priorities.
Thank you.
Also,
Yes. Next question. Oregon's suicide rate and incidents of domestic violence have risen sharply during the coronavirus epidemic, and gun purchases have skyrocketed. What are your thoughts on gun safety measures, such as passage of safe storage law or increased enforcement of the extreme risk protection law?
Lynette, this is an issue that's near and dear to my heart. I have been active with Moms Demand Action since the very beginning of that organization. And, you know, that's in two decades in the field as a paramedic and TE, I've seen more gun violence, whether that's domestic violence related or more frequently self-inflicted than I'd ever like to remember. So that experience has really informed my advocacy in that. And I have been working since with these bills since the very beginning, going to Salem and advocating and trying to find middle ground, because I think most people just want to know that they're safe, and our access to safety comes through, you know, folks who who feel like they need their gun to be safe. And then there are folks that feel like, you know, I want my kids to be safe. So there is middle ground there. I think now that the single greatest bill, we passed the extreme risk protection, already showing life-saving changes in the state. The sheriffs like it. It was a proven winning strategy. So the next step is to take secure storage. And that is making sure that people, especially with children around, have their firearms locked up. That doesn't mean that they're taken away. There's no criminal liability with that. It's just saying that it's, and I think if we can prevent one more death, one more needless suicide, then we've accomplished something. And to me, it's sort of like seatbelts. You know, people really felt like their liberties were being infringed when they were told they had to buckle seatbelts, but it was a public safety measure. Gun violence is a public safety issue, and we need to take a policy lens to it as well as a human compassionate lens.
Thank you so much. What steps would you recommend to address the budgetary shortfalls for K-12 and secondary education?
Absolutely. I think there's a lot of calls right now to dial back Student Success Act and the CAT tax, and I absolutely adamantly am against that. We need to show up for our students like we never have before. This COVID-19 crisis has really, again, shined a magnifying glass on privilege and access. And if we cut back on the very things that were put forward with Student Success Now, we're doing a massive disservice to these students that has to be there for them. There are ways that the CAT tax was written with some flexibility in it to begin with. So there are structures, there are relief structures already built into that. And secondly, we need to be thinking long-term and big picture. If we don't set up infrastructure and take care of our students now and make sure everyone has access, and that we also provide for wraparound services like pre-K, childcare, and post-secondary paths to education, then we're really selling our whole economic future short. So it's easy to get really bound up in the next 24 months. You know, how are we going to get through this? But we really need to be big picture thinkers here.
Thank you. Why should voters choose you over your opponent?
You know, I don't know a whole lot about my opponent. He has declined thus far to meet, so I only know what I read on his website and the internet. And I really feel like I have this frontline experience for almost two decades. I have relationships that I have built in Salem. I have been showing up for the people of Oregon and the people in my district repeatedly, whether it's from the Compassionate Care Clinic to coaching track at the local middle school to all these different ways that I show up for my community. I have seen what one brave voice, what a difference that can make. And I know the pathways, I know the policies, I know how to get there on a bigger scale. So not a knock on my opponent at all. I believe that I am in a position, I have the support, and I have the experience to bring real change and real protection for what we're gonna go through in the next several years for House District 35. I know this district and I love this district.
Thank you. In closing, because time flies, is there anything else that you would like to tell the voters?
Yeah, absolutely. There's one thing I would like to address that has come up repeatedly in a couple interviews, and that is apparently my opponent has been saying that I am backed by special interests because I have received sweeping endorsements from unions and advocacy groups. And my answer to that is, if you're calling firefighters, teachers, nurses, carpenters, plumbers, electricians, frontline grocery workers, folks in janitorial services and property services, home healthcare workers, if you're calling those special interests, then absolutely 100% I stand for those interests because those are the people that make Oregon work and I intend to show up for them.
Well, thank you, Dacia. We appreciate you coming in today. Stay safe. And voters, please remember to vote 411 for all your ballot information. Thank you.